yourself a song to sing and sing it till you're done. Yes, sing it hard and sing it well. Send the robber barons straight to hell. The greedy thieves who came around and ate the flesh of everything they found. Whose crimes have gone unpunished now. Walk the streets a screaming now. Greetings, all you 99%ers. This is your host, Dr. Jack Rasmus. This is Alternative Visions. The theme today is the U.S. next recession. As you know, more and more business and bank research departments and economists and commentators are beginning to realize that the recession's around the corner. And we're getting new discussion themes. Like, the U.S. economy is really doing great, much better. What's all this talk about recession? You know, that's emanating from the Trump administration, largely, and supporters of Trump. So we're going to talk about that theme. Is the U.S. really doing so much better? I also want to visit then the theme of those who are, you know, trying to split the middle by saying, oh, okay, so a recession may be coming, but it's going to be mild. That, you know, it's not going to be like 2008-09. There's no evidence of a housing bubble, right? So it's not going to be like that. It's going to be much more moderate. So I want to take on that argument and offer some counter evidence that it necessarily won't be so mild. Then I want to finish up on a third theme, and that is what's gone down here in Latin America with Argentina and the collapse of financial assets down there, spreading throughout Latin America, and how that is really a reflection of deflating financial asset market prices everywhere globally now. What does that mean for the fact that there may be a recession coming? By the way, I just want to remind listeners that I've been predicting a recession for well over a year now. And it could come as early as the end of this year. Not likely, but it could. But certainly within the next 12 to 15 months. I think more likely sooner than later. But we shall see. But unlike many mainstream economists, my analysis is that we are much closer to the brink than people say. Or that school of thought, oh, we're really doing great. Or that a little more cautious school of thought, okay, it's coming, but it will be mild. All right, so let's just jump into that. By the way, you know, if you are interested in some of the data points that I've been throwing up here on Twitter, where I have an account which is at Dr. Jack Rasmus. Check it out. You may want to sign up because I'm mostly referring to data evidence of various kinds that show that this is happening. We're getting closer. Then on my blog, jackrasmus.com, I provide deeper analysis of that same subject matter. In fact, an article I've posted there and on the various blogs, you can check it out, entitled Argentina and the Next Global Financial Crisis, has been getting a lot of interest, a lot of hits. So if you want a deeper analysis, I'll talk about that topic at the close of today's show. But, you know, if you want to read something, just go to my blog and read that entry here earlier this week, or check out my tweets where I'm referring to evidence, quantitative evidence usually, of the growing drift towards a recession and other issues like government deficit and debt. Okay. So, all right. So let's begin here. Let's begin. Let's take up this theme here first, that the U.S. economy is doing great, right? You heard that one. Okay. Let's talk about this. All right, so excuse me, I'm a little distracted here by an incoming call. A lot of interviews here requested in the last couple of days, and I've been jumping on a lot of that. Okay, so let's get down to the discussion. Is the U.S. economy really doing so great? Well, if you listen to Trump friends and Trump himself and his advisors, Kudlow, Navarro, and others, well, it sounds like it, right? And if you pick up on the business and even the general media here, they keep saying that jobs are doing so good and wages are doing so good and now consumption and retail purchases are doing okay, it seems, holding their own. But if you look behind the general economy, not just these lagging indicators, lagging, that means that, you know, jobs and wages and consumption are usually lagging indicators, meaning they're not at the leading predictive edge of where things are and they're going. Look at the U.S. economy. Manufacturing is flat or slowing. It depends what the region of the country is, or slowing rapidly, or is flat, or it's even declining in certain regions. It's part of the global manufacturing recession that's already here. In other countries, including Europe and China, manufacturing is contracting. And in the U.S., it's now slowing down as well. That's because of the collapse of global trade. Global trade now is only, what, 0.5%, the latest data I showed, growing only at 0.5%? Well, that's not very much. And by now, it's probably flat, altogether flat. It's never been, that's unique. It's never happened before that global trade has occurred. Okay, so let's continue. Manufacturing is flat. Construction, investment in construction and housing has been declining for six consecutive quarters. Okay, so construction is about 8% of the economy, total economy, 12% roughly in manufacturing. So about 20%, 1/5 of the economy is down. But close to another 10% is real investment, or what's called net private domestic investment. Well, that was negative last quarter, second quarter, negative. So you got about 1/3 of the economy that is flat and negative. Now, it's important that this 1/3 of the economy, the rest is consumption, this 1/3 of the economy is the most important driver of the business cycle. Yeah, most important. What do we mean by that? Well, it usually leads the direction of the economy. Investment is what drives the economy. An investment in manufacturing and structures, commercial property, residential, office and, you know, other plant and equipment, right? This is what I'm talking about when I talk about all of these sectors are flat or declining in the U.S., which is a harbinger of what's going to then spill over to the lagging indicators, consumption, right? 2/3 of the economy. Well, consumption is driven by three things. One is jobs. The other is wages or forms of non-wage income, if you're in the upper 10%, i.e. stock appreciation, other investments appreciation. But it's also driven by credit. If you look at why consumption and retail sales is holding up, even though lagging, it's mostly because of credit. Record levels of consumer credit have been added, particularly credit cards, auto, and so forth, in recent months. Well, what about high-end consumption driven by stocks and bonds? Well, stock income, in other words, financial asset appreciation. Well, as we know, that's been sharply declining. So people, you know, who are doing quite well aren't spending quite as much because their value of their investments in stocks and other securities has been declining now. What about jobs? Well, you hear a lot about jobs, don't you? Yeah. About we've got only a 3.7% unemployment rate. Well, that's bullshit. Because that refers to what's called the U3 unemployment rate, which is just full-time workers, which aren't growing. The growth is largely in part-time. And that's not reflected in the 3.7% unemployment rate. Or maybe it's 3.9 now, I'm not sure. Right? If you look at the inclusion of part-time, you're really 7 to 8% unemployment. And I believe that's also an underestimation because the government data only is factoring in part-time employment where part-time is your primary job. What we got going in the job numbers, jobs have been created, I believe, and this is controversial, but this is my increasing belief, is that the job hiring represents second and third part-time jobs that don't get picked up in the part-time employment totals, but they do get picked up in the job creation totals. When they talk about unemployment or employment, they're talking about jobs. They're not talking about workers getting a job. It's not a person. It's a job that's created. So if we're creating more second and third part-time jobs, it looks like we're growing the total job numbers and the total number of employed. But I don't believe we are growing the total number of employed as fast as those numbers indicate, because they're more likely second and third jobs. And because they're second and third jobs, they're not being picked up in the part-time job total, which only picks up primary jobs. In other words, your primary job is a part-time job. Okay, so in other words, the devil's in the detail in the job numbers. And if this phenomenon I'm describing is correct, what you get is a total number of jobs being created, but not necessarily an equivalent number of employees getting jobs, workers getting jobs. And you get an underestimation of the part-time job totals in the economy. You know, about 160 million total jobs in the U.S. workforce, at least 60 million are part-time temp contingent jobs, as we call them. So one-third. But those jobs aren't being accurately factored in to the total employment number. So both the U3 full-time employees only, and even the U6, which factors in primary part-time jobs, don't reflect the true numbers of people who are employed or unemployed. And if we're having more part-time jobs being created, second, third, as well as primary, then the job numbers are underestimated, or the unemployment numbers are underestimated, right? I believe there we're still at least around 10% unemployment, 9 to 10% here. That means that the job numbers are not really driving a consumption, which suggests that the credit numbers are driving it. And up until recently, you know, high-end capital gains driven for households and top 10% are driven consumption. What about wages? Right? Well, if you look at the data, since 2011, we've been shifting out full-time jobs and replacing them with part-time jobs and temp jobs. These don't pay full wages. The wage numbers of 3.1%, right, wage gains, I believe, is inaccurate. Well, why? Well, as I've said before, that 3.1% is not adjusted for inflation. If the, you know, official inflation rate is 1.5, 1.6, well, the 3.1 is really half of that. Wages growing 1.5% instead of 3.1%. And if the inflation numbers also underestimate inflation, and I believe they do for the median level households, you know, that 3.1 or that 1.6 inflation rate is for the entire economy and all the goods, but median income families spend more of their income on certain goods that are rising faster than the average in inflation, you know, primarily apartments and the housing and healthcare premiums and drug prices and education costs and so forth. All right. So let's just say that the 3.1% wage is, in real terms, really half of that, 1.5%. All right, that's not the whole picture. Because the 3.1% or 1.5% represents full-time employees. And remember, you got 60 million people in the workforce now who aren't full-time. So it's full-time only. And on top of that, it's an average for everybody, for all full-time employees. Right? And if the wage increases are greater at the top 10% of what's called the wage structure, in other words, they're getting more than 3.1 or 1.5, right? That means those at the median and below are getting much less than 3.1 or 1.5 in order to average out. And it's the top 10% who aren't the traditional working class. You know, they are managers and supervisors, professionals, self-employed contractors, and so forth, right? But if you're, you know, working in a service company or a Walmart or at in a factory or whatever, you know, you're in that category, right, of more like the median, the midpoint, and you're not getting that kind of average. You're getting less than the 3.1, 1.5 average. You're getting less, maybe one, maybe less. Right? So wages aren't growing, really, when you look at the mass, the 80% of the workforce, you know, over 100 million households. Maybe wages are growing on average, if you're full-time employed, around 1%. And if you're not full-time, if you're many of the 60 million-plus people who are, you know, patching together two and three part-time jobs to make ends meet, your wages aren't growing at all. You may be adding total income as you add second and third jobs, but your wages aren't growing. All right, if wages aren't growing for most of the folks and jobs are poor pay, low quality, second, third, part-time jobs. Where's this consumption coming from? As I said at the beginning, it's coming from credit. People loading up on record credit, including credit card debt. Right? And businesses are front-loading. In other words, they are providing discounts now to keep, you know, their sales volume up that they'll have to pay for later in the year. A good example is the auto industry, right? Slowing dramatically now, not just for regular sedans, but SUVs and even trucks now slowing. So what are the auto companies doing? Well, to keep the sales up desperately, what they're doing is offering deep discounts to, in effect, lower the price. That's going to, you know, prevent the collapse, a faster collapse of auto sales here for maybe another 6 months. But then it's really going to be felt next year. People who might have bought next year and buying now because of the discounts, well, they won't buy next year and it'll be even worse. All right, so to sum up here, how well is the economy really doing? Well, as I said, the leading edges that drive the business cycle, manufacturing, construction, and real investment, plant and equipment, they're all stagnant or falling. And yeah, consumption's hanging in there, but it's not because of job creation. It's not because of wage increases for most, although some at the top. It's because of credit. And that can't go on, you see. Already we're beginning to see the problem emerge in autos. 7 million people have defaulted on their auto loans. 7 million. How can that be a reflection of a healthy household consumption? It can't. You know, that's an indicator, a flashing red indicator that the households are not as well off as everyone says they are, at least the 80% of them. Yeah, the top is doing okay. Yeah, even of workers and wages. Yeah, top 10%, they're doing, you know, in tech and professions and so forth. They're doing okay, but not the rest. The rest are living off of credit, and that can't last very long. Okay, so this whole theme of the U.S. economy is really doing much better. Look at jobs and wages, right? Look at consumption. Hides, it obfuscates what's really going on in the economy. The key sectors are turning down fast, and everything else is holding its own based on credit. All right, so let's go to the next one, the next sub-theme here, and that is, you know, those who are a little more acknowledgent of what's really going on and imminent recession around the corner say, oh, okay, well, maybe the economy's not doing all that great, and maybe we're going to have a recession. But, you know, the recession's going to be mild. That's another theme you hear in the business press. Recession's going to be mild. All right? Well, let's dissect that argument. First thing they say is that, well, there's no evidence of a housing bubble like we had in 2007 and 8, right? Which really exacerbated the crisis and the recession that followed in 2007-8. So the next recession will be more mild. Yeah. Well, they also then say, look at the 2001-2 recession, where the tech sector went bust, the dot-com bust, right? In 2000, led to the recession 2001-2. Well, there's no evidence that tech is going bust. Therefore, it'll be mild. Or they even say, you know, let's go back to the recession before that in 1990-91, which was precipitated by collapse of the junk bond markets at the time or just before. And they say, well, look, there's no evidence of junk bond collapse. I would argue with that. But nonetheless, they say there's no evidence of that. In 89, there's no evidence of a dot-com bust in tech. There's no evidence of of it being really serious, the way the subprime mortgage collapse occurred in 2007 and 2008. Therefore, it will be, if it comes, and yeah, it may come, it's going to be minor. Well, my replies to those arguments are as follows, right? No one saw the housing bubble. There were some folks coming in 2007 and 2008 that would lead to a freeze up of the financial system in general and spill over to the real economy, because that's the way it happened, you see, right? You got the housing bust, which led to a bust in the banking system, shadow banking, and then the real banking system that froze up lending totally. The whole financial system froze up, and that, of course, spilled over to the real economy thereafter. We had that deep and long recession called the Great Recession, you see. No one saw that is where the housing bubble, actually is the derivatives housing bubble. You know, they often leave out the role of derivatives credit, which really accelerated the contagion and the contraction of in the subprime mortgage sector. But they didn't see that coming then. So just because you don't see a housing bubble now doesn't mean that it's coming from another direction this time. And ditto, we could say the same thing for the tech dot-com bust in 2000. Right? No one saw that coming at the time until it was here. I'm sure they were talking about, look, the junk bonds that caused the 89-90 recession, there's no problem with our junk bonds. Well, they didn't see it coming out of left field with the tech bust. Just as in 2007, they were saying, well, tech is in good shape. You know, they didn't see it coming with the housing bust. And if you go back to 89, they didn't see the junk bond bust coming. They were probably looking at the 81-82 recession, you know, and said, oh, government policy, you know, interest rates are not as high, and that provoked the 81-82 recession. Well, you know, in 89, we don't have that problem. Yeah, but you had a new problem called junk bonds. And that precipitated the 1991 recession. And you had a new problem called tech.com bust in 2000. That precipitated the 2001-2. And then you had another different one, the housing subprime derivatives bust in 2007-2008. My point is that they never see the new one coming. They never see it coming in a new area. They never see the new financial contraction and deflation that precipitates the crash of the financial markets, generates a massive credit crunch, and spills over to the real economy, the non-financial economy, and causes it to contract. Where's the next one coming from? Well, it's not going to be housing. No, I agree. It's not going to be tech. Probably not going to be junk bonds, but maybe not, because junk bonds are in pretty bad shape. Where are some of the possibilities, the candidates, you might say, for the next financial contraction that pushes the economy, which is almost flat now before financial crisis, over the real economy, over into a recession? Well, I think the junk bond market is today one of the shaky places, particularly in the energy sector. Half of all the junk bonds have been pretty much issued by shale drillers and energy. And what we see is deflation going on in global oil, crude oil prices, 20-30% already, which is a repeat for what happened at the end of last year. Yeah. And that collapse of prices may make it impossible for shale producers who have borrowed so much junk debt to continue drilling more and more, may make it very difficult for them to service that massive debt they've built up. In other words, pay the principal and interest on it. If they can't, they're going to default. And if enough of them default fast enough, which could happen, if prices keep falling for crude, they're already, you know, in the mid-50s. They'll be in the 40s before the end of the year. And if we have a recession, they could be in the 30s. Well, that's going to mean some of these energy companies, shale companies, cannot generate enough revenue with that low price to pay the principal and interest on their debt. And when they default, what happens is those that loan them that junk debt, i.e. shadow banks and so forth, they're going to go under. Oh, now we got contagion going from junk bonds to other sectors of the financial system. That's quite possible. And then there's really the de facto junk bond sector called triple B rated investment grade. Triple B rated investment grade debt. That's in bad shape, too. More and more of investment grade corporate bond investment grade debt is low quality, unlike ever before. Then there's what's called the leveraged loan market, which is really junk loans, you might say, that companies and investors have borrowed from in order to buy each other up, mergers and acquisitions, and so forth, right? Leveraged loans. Private equity shadow banks are the big culprit here. Right? That's over $1 trillion. Triple B, as I said before, is well several trillion. And junk bonds, well over $1 trillion. So just in the U.S., we have, you know, $3 to $5 trillion in very, very risky debt. And as long as prices can keep rising for the companies that have taken on that debt, they can generate enough cash flow to service, pay the principal and interest of that debt. But once the economy slows and their sales slow and they have to lower prices to maintain their market share, well, then they don't generate the revenue, the cash revenue, to continue principal and interest payments on their debt. And when they default, it sends a shockwave throughout the financial system, and other sectors start tightening up. And then there's no credit. They can't borrow unless the bank that they are, the source they borrowed from, is willing to roll over their junk debt. But at some point, the banks say, no, we're not giving you more money to pay the principal and interest on your loan debt because you can't pay that. How are you going to pay more? And they don't give any more to them. And then we get defaults, you see. It's when deflation that lowers revenue and cash flow reaches a point that they can't pay for their old debt, which has been massively increased over recent years, by the way, then they default. And defaults start the process in a downward spiral. Other financial prices, asset prices start collapsing. This is how financial cycles interact with the real economy. You see more and more as the global economy and U.S. economy become financialized, as we say, the financial cycles and financial markets play a bigger and bigger role in the general business cycle. This is something that mainstream economists don't even look at because they don't understand it at all. They're not trained in financial cycles. So your whole generations of mainstream economists have been trained in just looking at factors and variables that aren't financial. And therefore, if the real economy is now more financialized and these cycles interact with each other, they have no explanation. And that's why they can't forecast very accurately anymore, mainstream economists. They're worthless in terms of their predictions. And we saw that, you know, really in the last recession, and it hasn't changed very much. Okay, so junk bonds, the energy sector, triple B bonds, leverage loans. Another one is agricultural debt. Right? We could see a lot of agricultural companies, including agribusiness, get in some deep trouble because overlaid on this is the Trump trade war which is really whacking out the farm sector. And it can get worse if there's no trade deal, which there isn't going to be soon with China. To some extent, Trump has been able to dampen the effect on the farm sector loss of revenue because of trade by giving them subsidies, you know, $30 billion almost now, subsidies. And if this trade thing goes on longer into 2020, which it will, $50 billion will be given to farm, mostly agribusiness, you know, that they'll take from food stamps, which they are, or housing or other places, which he's doing, to give to his heartland red state political base. That's what he's doing. If you took that away, that $30, $50 billion, we'd have probably a deep recession already in the farm sector. All right, so agricultural debt may be an area. There's this esoteric area, I'm not going to get in great detail, called the repo market, repurchase agreements, in which, you know, very briefly, corporations use treasury bonds and bills as a collateral for borrowing from each other short term, right? There's a problem of perhaps liquidity drying up and they can't borrow for loans from each other, or the prices go up and therefore they got to pay more to borrow from each other. That can be a problem some have looked at. And then you could have some very notable big corporation in the U.S. or even global defaulting. I've been looking at General Electric in that sense for some time. And, of course, now it just came out yesterday that General Electric problem is much greater than they said, that they're hiding the extent of their financial problems. And GE has always been in financial difficulty because, you know, it's not just making airplane engines and light bulbs and stuff like that. It's a finance company. You know, GE almost collapsed in the 2008 crisis because its finance arm dragged it into default. And the government had to bail out GE. It did the same with General Motors, by the way. Its finance arm, General Motors Acceptance Corporation, was the big problem. Right? Look, a lot of these big multinational corporations are bankers. Yeah, portfolio investors, they call it. They're banks. They make a lot of their profits from speculating in financial markets. You know, about a third of their total revenues, on average, come from financial asset investing. There's part of the financialization going on. They would be part of what we would call shadow banks. And they aren't banks. They are producing, you know, commodities as well, real things, real goods. So they're kind of a hybrid, you see. So, you know, all of these markets are potential in the U.S. You know, we could have a big company like GE go default. That would have reverberations across the board. But what about the rest of the world, you know, candidates for the crisis next time, right? Not subprimes, not dotcom, not junk bonds, but somewhere else. Well, look at Europe. Trillions of dollars in non-performing bank loans. The banking sector is in a real crisis over in Europe. You can see the tip of the iceberg now and then. You know, Italian banks loaded up with hundreds of billions of non-performing. Non-performing means that whoever you loan the money to, they're not paying you back, you see. But German banks, you know, Deutsche Bank, Commerce Bank, we're going to see it in the UK again, especially if there's a Brexit, which there will be, it looks like. So in Europe, you got a problem. You got a. On top of that, you got you know, trillions and trillions of dollars of bonds in negative territory. In other words, negative rates. not just government bonds, but corporate bonds now, for the first time, are turning negative. Well, that means whoever bought those bonds, i.e. banks, are having a big problem earning revenue because interest rates are so low. They can't earn anything on the spread. So, you know, watch European banks, big trouble. Watch India banks, particularly shadow banks now. A lot of shady stuff been going on over in India, and now it's coming to the fore. A lot of scandals, a lot of speculation, you know, shadow banks, unregulated. That could take a big hit on the Indian financial system. We could have a classic kind of 2008-09 contraction over there. I think one of the areas is really shadow banks and the auto loan sector, and auto loans have pretty much dried up as a result. So watch India. Watch their hundreds of billions of non-performing loans, bank loans, and their shadow banking system causing instability. Brexit, if it happens, will exacerbate everything in Europe. And then we have, looking for the rest of the world, potential candidates for precipitating the next financial crisis. We got what's going on in Argentina, and really Latin America as a whole, but Argentina being the worst case, where we have financial assets collapsing. Currency is collapsing, 50% here in just this past 12, 18 months, maybe more. It was 20 Argentine pesos to the dollar. Now it's about 60 to the dollar. Currency collapse. When you have a currency collapsing that much, investors start moving their money out of that country. And that's what's happening. Capital flight, they call it. No. I mean, what investor is going to hold his investment in a currency that's collapsing in value, especially by that much? You're just losing money overnight by leaving it in that currency. So what are you going to do? You're going to take your money, your investment in that currency, you're going to sell it. Sell it means you're going to go and buy dollars or maybe Japanese yen, right? Before your collapse of your currency is going to mean you're going to afford fewer and fewer dollars. Afford to buy fewer and fewer dollars. You're going to convert, right? And by buying more and more dollars with your collapsing currency before it collapses further, you're driving up the value of the dollar. So the dollar appreciates in response to the collapse of these currencies. And they're collapsing all over South America. Well, they stabilized a little bit. Why do they stabilize a little bit temporarily? Because to stop the capital outflow, what the central banks of those countries do is raise their domestic interest rates. You know, instead of put your money in our government bonds, in other words, don't take it out of the country. You know, here we're paying you 75% in Argentina. That's what interest rates, the government rate now is 75%. Oh, okay. So it stops some of it. But ultimately, if the currency keeps falling, even raising interest rates doesn't work. And besides, raising interest rates, what does that do? Slows down your domestic economy even more, which drives, let's get our money out. We can't make a profit even further. At the same time, the collapsing currency means import inflation, the cost of buying goods from other countries, goes up dramatically and drives up the whole price level in your country, especially in these other countries, emerging markets, where, you know, they have to buy most of their stuff from other countries. So if their currency is falling, inflation for those goods is rising and driving up prices everywhere. At the same time, central bank raising interest rates causes contraction of the real economy more than ever before, both of which then stimulate capital flight even further. And if you're a multinational U.S. company doing business in Argentina, right, if the profits you are earning in the Argentine peso are falling, guess what you're going to do? You can't make a profit in those countries because the whatever profit, normal profit you make, is being offset by a collapse of the currency. So you're going to want to get your money out of there too, if you're a multinational corporation. You're certainly not going to bring more money in to expand production in that situation. Well, what can a country like Argentina do in this situation to stop the collapse of their currency? Well, they borrow from the IMF. The IMF gave its greatest loan ever to Argentina, $56 billion. Drained its reserves, the IMF's reserves. Where are they going to get more reserves if they have other multiple Argentinas? Now, that's a good question. Trump isn't going to give it to them. Yeah, IMF may be running out of money soon, too, for the first time. So they borrow from the IMF, which means that they got to sell more goods to earn more dollars to pay back the IMF. In other words, they got to export more. But if the global economy is slowing down and Trump's trade war is causing it to a large extent now, how are they going to sell more? Big problem, right? They can't generate the income from exports in order to pay off the debt to the IMF. Or not just the IMF, what you got in the case of Argentina was a lot of vulture capitalists, hedge funds and equity firms and others that once this business guy Macri got in office, loaned them and loaned Argentina businesses a record amount of private debt. So you got tens of billions in private debt, and now you got $56 billion in IMF debt. How are they going to pay that back? Well, Macri here has been squeezing workers and small businessmen. It's called austerity to pay for it. Well, what happened, though, at the beginning of the last weekend was that they had a primary to the presidential election coming up in October, and Macri got smashed. His challenger got 46% of the vote. He got 32 or 48 and 36, something like that, which means he's going to lose the election in October, which means a new president coming in, a guy named Alberto Fernandez, right, may reverse the very pro-Western financial interest policies of Macri. You see, first thing Macri did in 2015 when he came in was to pay the American hedge funds that had been demanding for years extra payments from Argentina, which Argentina's previous government to Macri would not pay. Well, when Macri gets in, first thing he did was to pay those guys off, Paul Singer, Elliott Capital Management, and so forth. Paid them off, billions. That's when he got the loan from IMF, you see. And then he went off to New York with his other Argentine business buddies and got more private loans. Who knows what he skimmed off the top. And these private loans are what we call dollarized, corporate debt, dollarized. So if the value of the dollar rises, the cost of that debt rises. The principal and interest payments rise if the dollar rises and if the peso devalues, which it is. Yeah. So, the big hedge fund guys that have thrown money after Macri got in office to Argentina are now facing losses themselves. Companies... vulture speculators like Templeton Securities and so forth in deep trouble now. That's a contagion channel, you see, that goes from the crisis in Argentina, Latin America, to the U.S. Okay, so recapping here this theme, that the recession will be mild simply because it won't happen the way it's happened before financially, is bogus because it's going to come out of left field in some other area, and I reviewed the possible weak areas in the U.S., and then I reviewed here some of the possible weak areas globally, the EU, India, Argentina, Latin America, Brexit, so forth, right? I would add to these potential candidates next time, as a refutation to this, oh, the recession will be mild, the fact that it's starting on a base of GDP, the next recession here, U.S. and global, much, much weaker than it was in 2007. The real economy is far weaker than it ever was before in 2007. That means that the contraction, when it comes, could be faster and deeper because it's weaker, both in the U.S. and globally. At the same time, the amount of debt that has been added to the old debt since 2007-08 is massive. We're talking about, you know, trillions, tens of trillions of dollars of new debt, government debt, particularly corporate debt, financial debt, to some extent household debt. Debt by itself is not the problem, if you can pay for it. And paying for it means that your income, whether it's business income as revenues, prices, volumes, right, or household income as wages, or government income as tax revenues, continues to rise. If your revenue, your cash flow rises, then you can add more debt and pay for it. But we've had just the opposite. We've been adding all this debt, and the ability to pay for it has been declining. And that's true of government. We reduce taxes, right? Ability to pay for government debt declining. Household, no wage growth, low wage job growth. Result is we're adding debt, credit card debt. A corporation is the same thing, right? Adding all this junk debt, trillions and trillions of dollars. And remember, the debt, the corporate debt in Argentina is dollarized, which makes it even worse. So we're in much weaker shape with massive debt and declining income to pay for it than we were in 2007-08. That means that it could be even worse next time. Plus, we don't know what are the new contagion channels and contagion mechanisms that have developed over the last 8 years. We're looking at the old contagion channels, you see. We don't understand the new mechanisms necessarily. That could be a big surprise. But finally, I would add, it could be worse than just a mild contraction, not only because weaker GDP and new contagion channels and because of these other candidates, but because fiscal and monetary policy has been rendered essentially ineffective in stimulating a recovery should occur. What do I mean by that? Well, look, let's just take the case of the U.S. One of the ways you stimulate a recovery is by lowering interest rates, right? Interest rates are already at 2% and going lower fast. And when you are at what's called the zero-bound zero rates or close to it, lowering rates further has little effect, far less effect than if you were at 5 or 6% and you lower the rates by 1%, right? They've shot their interest rate ammunition, and the central banks have never recovered. In Europe and Japan, they've recovered even less than the U.S. At least the U.S. raised interest rates to 2.375. In Europe, they never raised them. Japan, the same thing. They are starting with massive amounts of negative rates to try to stimulate the economy. Can you stimulate it with lowering rates further? No. In fact, lowering rates when they're negative has the opposite effect, you see. So monetary policy, central bank policy, lowering interest rates is dead in the water. Well, why is it? Because the Federal Reserve, the central bank, kept interest rates at 0.1% for 7 years after 2008-9. You see, the banks were bailed out in the U.S. by 2010 because of, you know, various measures, mostly done by the Federal Reserve to take their bad loans, bad debts, and put it on the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. That was called QE, quantitative easing, $5 to $6 trillion spent by the central bank buying up bad loans. And interest rates went to 0.1% and 1%. The banks were bailed out by 2010, but the Federal Reserve, Bernanke and then Yellen, kept the rates at 0.1% and 1% until late 2016, almost 2017. They kept the rates at zero. Why did he do that? Subsidizing the bankers and the financial system and capitalism in general. Monetary policy has changed. It used to be a tool for stimulating or slowing the real economy. After 2008, it became a tool for subsidizing capital incomes. And boy, did it subsidize them. The low interest rates enabled huge profits by corporations in general and banks in particular. Huge profits that were then redistributed to shareholders at an amazing rate and volume. From 2011 on, stock buybacks and dividend payouts averaged over $1 trillion a year every year. Averaged. And now, last year's $1.2 trillion. This year will be $1.5 trillion because of Trump tax cuts. Yes, a massive redistribution of income to owners of capital incomes, not wage earners, through stock buybacks and dividend payouts, made possible largely by keeping interest rates to 0.1% and 1% for 7 years. Monetary policy subsidized capital when it didn't need it, but it did it for political reasons. And now we're at 2%, and a recession's coming, and they have no ammunition left. You know, interest rates peaked at 5.25% in 2007. At least they had some leeway. Before the 2001 recession, they peaked at 6.5%. Before the 1990-91 recession, they peaked at 8%. In other words, they've been going down from 8 to 6.5 to 5.25 to 2 and 3.8, now 2. This subsidization has been going on for a long time, getting worse. That's part of what neoliberalism is about, subsidizing capital incomes in various ways. It's not just austerity and holding down wages, you see. It's boosting capital incomes through stocks and bonds and so forth, even more massively than holding down wages. That's why we have this growing income inequality. It's not just because folks haven't gotten wage increases. It's because some folks got big payouts in shareholder capital incomes. Well, that means going into the next recession, monetary policy is dead in water. That may make the next recession worse. What about fiscal policy? Well, we've, through policies from George W. Bush to Trump here, 2018, $15 trillion in tax cuts for investors and businesses. $15 trillion. That's what we've given them. As a result, we have a deficit that's now over $1 trillion for as far as we can see. And if we have a recession, the CBO said it could go to $1.7 trillion a year. You know, we're going to be $34, $35 trillion by 2027 in terms of the national debt. And the interest on that alone, according to the CBO, is going to be $900 billion a year. Well, with that kind of deficit and debt, do you think they're really going to be able to try to stimulate the economy with tax cuts for the middle class in the next recession? No, they won't be able to. And that's why fiscal and monetary policy are both dead in the water. And that could mean a worse recession next time.